Hello, everybody, and welcome back. I told you this morning we would have an enlightening and empowering session, and wow, did we ever. Just tremendous presentations from leaders in our field, helping us to better understand this issue of wellness, well-being, stress, burnout, the consequences of both the systems that we work in and the work that we do. So I am absolutely delighted to be back with you to moderate our panel. And we are happy to feature experts from within the University of South Florida, USF Health, and our sister College of Behavioral and Community Science. I want to introduce to you Dr. Kelly Allegro. She's co-director of clinical education at our School of Physical Therapy and Rehabilitation Science at USF Health. Dr. Christopher Simmons, associate director, an associate professor of instruction, School of Social Work in the College of Behavioral and Community Science. Dr. Kristin Kosyluk, assistant professor, Department of Mental Health, Law and Policy, also in our College of Behavioral and Community Science. And Dr. Abraham Salinas-Miranda, director of the Harrell Center for the Prevention of Violence and associate director, Center of Excellence in Maternal and Child Health, assistant professor, College of Public Health, USF Health. So thank you all for joining us this morning. Wonderful colleagues from USF. And as we have all said, we're looking now to hear from you on what we might do with all of this information that we've been presented this morning and everything that you know from your own work. So I'm going to ask each of you a question or two, and then hopefully we will get some questions from the audience. Those of you that are with us, please go ahead and feel free to add any question to the Q&A or the chat feature, and we will get to those after we hear a little bit from each of our presenters. So thank you again for being here. Dr. Salinas, I'm going to start with you. I want to start with a broad sort of perspective from a public health perspective. Can you share with us how you think we might design interventions or develop policies to support the mental health needs of all caregivers?
Thank you, Dr. Petersen, and thank you everyone who is joining us today. Yeah, first of all, we've been talking about trauma, compassion fatigue, suicide, violence exposure was mentioned. And we have all these initiatives that are very vertical, that are focused on intimate partner violence, child maltreatment, professional resilience, but there is no single unifying framework. So one step that we need to take as a system of providers, services, policies, and programs is to recognize that we need to unify efforts. Instead of everybody doing their own thing according to their specialties. That is, we need a framework. We need a framework that can address suicide, same as traumatic stress, same as stress injury, same as interpersonal violence. That framework it needs to be comprehensive. So there has to be at least three principles that we need to include in such a framework. A socio-ecological view, so not just the individual level traumatic responses that happens, the family, the community level as well, and organizational and policy level, recognizing there are systemic stressors such as racism, oppression, discrimination, and inequities in the social determinants of health as well. The second is a life course perspective, recognizing that the person that we're seeing, the community that we're seeing now, they need to be seen as a three-generational approach. So previous generation, current generation, and the next generation, children. So whatever we do for the children and the mother, it will have implications for the community and vice versa. And the last but not least, a salutogenic approach. Instead of focusing so much on the deficit base, trauma, depression, we need to flip the narrative to relational health. So the real question is, what policies can we develop to develop families that are flourishing, thriving, well-being, and resilient. So I would start there, Dr. Petersen.
Thank you, Abraham. And that echoes a lot of what I heard this morning is about sort of reframing the conversation to something that's more positive, more forward-thinking, more intentional. So I want to turn to Dr. Simmons next. From a social work perspective, you also think about systems. And so I'm wondering if you can help us understand how important is it for professionals to collaborate in creating a comprehensive support system for themselves as peers. And you're on mute. I had to say that at least once.
Yeah. So thank you for allowing me to be here to talk with you guys. I think it's important to have collaboration, but I must say that it's also important to have a sort of a culture of respect, right, between the collaborators, and make sure that everyone who is on the team is valued, right, and respected, and they have to feel like they can contribute to the team. So we could talk about collaboration, and I think that's important. You know, I think about my work at the Bridge Clinic, for example. You know, one of the main things that the students say is that a lot of times they don't feel respected. Social work doesn't, you know, get the respect that they deserve on these teams. So, and it was good to hear one of the speakers said, I think it was Dr. Bickle, who said that, you know, it has to be anything that you do, any initiative that you do has to be inclusive, right? And people have to feel valued. And I think that's the most important thing when we're looking at collaboration and, you know, building these support systems for you know, students and peers and colleagues.
So what I'm hearing you say, because I think we heard in one of the presentations that peer support is more powerful than self-care. What you're suggesting is peer support, before we even get to peer support, we have to have respect across the different professions and the different roles, and appreciate what people, where they're coming from, and what they contribute. That's Absolutely. an important element before you can ever get to any kind of interprofessional peer support. To Abraham's point, it can't be vertical peer support. It needs to be cross peer support. Is that a fair?
Absolutely. Amen. Absolutely.
And the Bridge Clinic Dr. Simmons is referring to, for those of you that aren't here at USF Health, is a student-run clinic, an interprofessional student-run clinic that serves people in the local community. And actually, people come here from around the state because of the care that is provided there to low-income, uninsured communities. So thanks for bringing that up, Dr. Simmons. Yeah. I want to turn to Dr. Kosyluk, because we've heard a lot about stigma. We heard that you're an expert, so we're very happy that you're here. So if it's true that stigma around seeking health care is a problem, then how might we understand how stigma influences healthcare workers' ability to seek help?
Thank you, Dr. Petersen. That's a great question. I was kind of giggling to myself earlier that I was really thankful for the mute button and the stop video button earlier, because all of our speakers have really hit on a lot of the important ways that we can address stigma. And I was in the background going, yes, yes. So how does it influence our healthcare workers? You know, stigma is a process, and it really is comprised of three constructs, the first being stereotypes. So there's a couple that have come up today that are incredibly damaging. One is violence or dangerousness. So we tend to believe that people that are living with a mental health condition are a danger to themselves or others. And the other one that I think is probably particularly impactful for healthcare workers is that of incompetence. So when we are aware of these stereotypes, which I would argue that most of us are, and we have an emotional reaction, which is the next step in the stigma process, we call that prejudice. Oftentimes in response to the stereotype of dangerousness, it's one of fear. Incompetence, it can be one of self-blame. And then the final step in this process is discrimination. And Dr. Davidson did a really nice job of highlighting how that plays out at a structural level for our healthcare workers, but it can also take place at an individual level. And so that's what we term self-stigma, is when an individual who identifies as struggling with their mental health, whether or not they've been diagnosed yet, And they internalize the stereotypes that are so prevalent in society, namely those dangerousness and incompetence stereotypes. And they experience a loss of self-efficacy and self-esteem as a result. And that can lead to either not engaging with treatment at all, or, and this is true of the general population, but even more so for healthcare providers, if they do engage with care, dropping out early before the treatment can be helpful for them. And then it also affects us in general, but also the healthcare provider population in, you know, thwarting our ability to pursue goals because of those beliefs that people with mental health conditions are incompetent and incapable. And then finally, you know, I was thinking as I was listening to the other speakers this morning, you know, this idea of imposter syndrome has come up a couple times. And I never thought of it before today, but it really is rooted in stigma and the stereotypes around incompetence. So I think that those are probably the biggest ways that stigma impacts our healthcare community.
That's helpful. And I'm wondering, because I also heard a couple of our speakers speak about the hierarchy within healthcare teams. And I'm wondering if that imposter syndrome and some of this, you know, sort of self-stigmatizing behavior is affected by, you know, what is sometimes a sort of hidden, or maybe not so hidden, feeling of where you belong in the hierarchy, and how much, as Christopher just said, how much self-esteem do you actually bring to what you're doing? Do you have any thought on that?
Yeah. And I guess that the way I would respond to that is kind of this idea of flipping it, which I love the strengths-based approach. And when it comes to addressing stigma, I think one very important thing in organizations where there is that hierarchical structure is that we get messaging from the very top level of the organization that, not to sound cliche, but it's okay not to be okay. And I can talk about this more maybe perhaps later if there's time, but we know that storytelling or contact-based stigma change approaches are most effective for reducing stigma. So that's hearing about both the challenges somebody's experienced with regard to their mental health, but also their recovery journey and their message of hope. And those stories coming from higher level administration could be so life-saving for our healthcare providers. It gives them permission to be vulnerable too.
Yeah, thank you. I will come back to that. I think that's an important concept. Dr. Allegro, let's get down to something practical here. You are our PT expert, and so we know you have lots of tools and tricks. And I'm wondering if there are particular approaches or even exercises that you have seen helpful in helping people kind of deal with stress and burnout and all of the things that we're talking about here that might be something we could use immediately.
Thank you, Dr. Petersen. Thanks for having me. So, I mean, it's no surprise. I wouldn't say that there's a specific exercise, but there's no surprise that we know that physical activity boosts mood and it improves sleep. It reduces stress, improves cognitive performance. I'm going to share this quote by John Rady he's a psychiatrist at Harvard School of Medicine. He says, exercise is the single best thing you can do for your brain in terms of mood, memory, and learning. And as physical therapists, we really, truly live by this. I think in terms of ourselves, one thing that we teach our students, at least in the school of physical therapy, is we teach them not just the importance of physical wellness, but the importance of all the dimensions of wellness. Swarbrick came up with the 8 dimensions of wellness, which includes the emotional, environmental, financial, intellectual, et cetera. Our students are really focused on that intellectual wellness right now, right? So really, trying to encourage them to look at different ways, you know, and exercise. Physical wellness can be one way. And that exercise could be just walking for 20 minutes a day, being outside, getting some environmental wellness. I share the same thing with my patients. Sometimes they come in and they're just, their sympathetic nervous system is just overloaded, and they want a specific exercise to get better. And when they come in like that, I think to myself, you know, the only exercise I want you to do is to walk 20 minutes per day. And they look at me like if I'm crazy. They're like, just walk? I'm like, just walk. Just walk 20 minutes a day. Let's start there. And then we'll revisit your exercises next session.
Yeah, I think we forget sometimes it's the simple things. We don't need anything very, very elaborate. I hope, by the way, that when Dr. Okuda's been giving you breaks, that you're getting up and moving around. We can get locked into these. We sit here and we look at a screen all day. It is important to get up and move. I think there's plenty of evidence to support that. If I could stay with you a moment, Dr. Allegro. So our focus here is really on how we create supportive interprofessional teams. So have you found any specific ways to promote this collaboration across interprofessional teams, kind of peer support we're talking about, the kind of ways we can elevate the mental health of the entire team?
Well, let me just say that I'm very fortunate that I, on top of my other duties at USF, I am still treating a few hours a week at the, and we're an interprofessional setting, the concussion clinic. And, you know, I kind of chuckled a little bit when I heard earlier about how, you know, this hierarchy that we talk about and how we have to build a culture where we're all kind of on this same level. And I 100% feel that. I think this is the first clinic I've ever worked at at USF where I felt that. And I work in a team of athletic trainers and physicians, and we huddle up almost every single time I come into the clinic, and we ask each other's opinions on things, and we go through our patient caseload, and what do you think about this patient? And we look at the patient holistically. And sometimes it's, you know, I think it's just culturally I come in and everybody says, good morning to you. How are you doing? We share podcasts and audiobooks that we're listening to. Some on self-care because we treat patients that have suffered brain injuries. And, you know, it's easy to take on that emotional stress as a healthcare provider. And so we talk about ways that we're dealing with that. And we try to take the stigma away of, you know, our self-care. So I think right now I'm just very fortunate that that's just the culture that I practice in. And it's a common discussion amongst the whole team.
So that reinforces something we heard this morning, that just operating in a truly interprofessional environment is helpful to the mental health of the team. And I think it gets back to what we've also heard earlier. It's about respect for each member of the team and a recognition that each of us contributes in our own ways. And that it's that what, you know, the whole is greater than the sum of the parts concept. And so I think what you're saying is even just walking into that space and being greeted and being part of that conversation can be helpful to each person on that team to feel that they are an important member of that team. It seems like that's something we've been talking about a lot here at USF Health, is trying to create more of those experiences that you're having, not only because it's good for patients, but I think what we're hearing today is reinforcing that it's also good for the team. Mm-hmm. It's just good for the team. So sort of on that theme, back to you, Dr. Simmons. Are there interprofessional approaches you've seen and ways where you can elevate the social work aspect of a team to really try to help support caregivers, especially in diverse teams?
I think I'm going to always do that. Thank you for that question. I think, you know, just kind of piggybacking on the respect that, in interprofessional teams, because I only have, you know, the one, which is Bridge. And, you know, if you know Bridge Healthcare Clinic, you know that the medical team changes every year, the social workers change every year. So you might get a team that doesn't really understand, I don't know if they don't understand the value of the other disciplines, but they don't really. I'll just say possibly they don't understand. But if you have a team that truly wants to understand the other disciplines and, you know, wants, you know, you don't have that hierarchical structure, you know, that we talked about, then you know, I think the contribution of the different team, you'll see that, you know, you'll see that the contribution of the different teams. So one of the things, that, you know, and I'll pivot a little bit if you don't mind. One of the things that I thought about, because, you know, we do huddles at Bridge every Tuesday night, and it would be wonderful to do sort of a gratitude huddle, you know, incorporate that into the huddle. So, you know, you could, and we all know what gratitude does, you know, like if you thank someone for their work, you feel good, the receiver feels good, and the people around you, you know, they, you know, they feel good as well. So it has this ripple effect. So I think if we were to incorporate things like that, or even, you know, like different times that we could do, like maybe a 90-second meditation throughout the shift, those things I think would be great for that environment or any interprofessional environment. And it's not just a social work thing, but I think it would bring the groups together. And I think that's what's sort of missing on interprofessional teams. Even though they're interprofessional, they still sort of work in silos. I mean, we train the social workers, but we don't necessarily train the doc students or the physical therapy students, right? So we do a huddle in social work, and then we go out and, you know, interact with the other disciplines, but it's sort of, you know, it's sort of siloed. And I think if you have an interprofessional team, you know, there should be not only cross-cultural communication, but there should be, I think, cross-cultural, relationships, you know, I can't think of the other word that I'm trying to think of, but interactions is what I wanted to say. So I think, you know, there's work to be done at Bridge, and Bridge is sort of a microcosm, I think, of you know, the whole interprofessional atmosphere or environment that we find ourselves in, like hospitals and other clinics and things like that.
Well, you know, it's interesting hearing you say that, and I think you know, you're speaking truth. Why this is such a challenging effort to do well. We all have our own separate accreditations. We all have our own licensure. We all have our own codes of ethics. I used to teach an undergrad class where they were all pre-health students, and I would have them look at the different codes of ethics and across all the professions and say, okay, what's common and what's not, and why do you think that is? And, you know, really eye-opening for them to think about how different professions view their role. But in this context of what we're discussing here today about care for caregivers, it almost seems like, particularly what the last speaker said, this affects everybody. This affects every single member of a team, that maybe this is a topic around which we can come together as equals, because there is no hierarchy, even though it might play out in the stigma and the self, the care seeking, right? But there's really no hierarchy in the experience, is what I'm trying to say. And so maybe there's an opportunity here, as, you know, sort of, it's the topic is something we're really wanting to work on, and so that we can protect our caregivers, but it might be a way to also build stronger interprofessional teams.
Yes. Right?
Does that sound crazy?
Yes, absolutely. And I would even dare say, like, really, like, to have a culture of inclusiveness, right, would not only mean, you know, the social workers, doc students, you know, PT students, pharmacy students, nurses, nursing students, but to include staff.
Exactly.
You know, as well, you know, and that's truly inclusive. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is building a culture of inclusiveness.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for that. So now that makes me think I'm going to go back to Dr. Salinas, because now, you know, now we're talking about, you know, sort of true interprofessionalism. But you said something really interesting about intergenerational And what Dr. Simmons just said is we have cohorts of students, and every year they're new, and every year they're new to this concept. Right. In a healthcare environment, it's not so much that you have new cohorts every year, but you have people entering and exiting. And so how do you think about an intergenerational approach to this, not just families the way you think about it, but I'm just thinking now, I love this topic, you know, new people coming into a healthcare environment, people that are already there, people that are exiting, hopefully exiting on their own terms, as we just heard, with the kind of, you know, feeling like they've had a supportive environment within which. So I just wonder if you have any thoughts about that.
Yeah, one of the elements that we can do in public health is we love to assess the progress, the baseline, the trend. So one of the things that is missing in these fields on interprofessional resilience is setting the benchmarks, the metrics of safe, stable, nurturing relationships and environments. So if we're thinking intergenerational, if we develop metrics that we assess our students, our coworkers, staff, everybody in the team, everybody really, on what are the metrics of safe, stable, nurturing relationships and environment, we'll be able to see how we're doing with every cohort. We will be able to assess their needs and wellness plans, really employee wellness programs, student outreach programs, can look at those to set goals and implement intervention. But currently, to my knowledge, that's something that is emerging. The American Academy of Pediatrics and CDC recommends safe, stable, nurturing relationship and environments for children. I would say and challenge them, why only for children and not everybody? If you care for the parents and the students and everybody, intergenerational and across organizations, then children will benefit. But that would be my point, metrics, assessing that. Yeah.
Yeah, and I think we heard that, again, that reinforces something we heard this morning, that you don't just assume, you need to assess. And we heard of interesting ways to assess in an anonymous way so that no one has to be revealed. We heard the importance of that in terms of people being very fearful of losing a job, losing a license, and therefore not seeking help. So I'd like to go back to you, Dr. Kosyluk. So you said before, and I'm fascinated, that there are tools such as storytelling that can be really helpful for people who, I think for a lot of us, when we're feeling some of the things and I loved the scale of, you know, you're ready, you're reacting, you're injured, you're ill. We often feel alone, like we're the only one that's experienced it. So I'd love to hear your thoughts on things like storytelling as a tool.
Yeah. And isn't that so kind of absurd? We're a logical group, I think, right? We rely heavily on evidence, and the evidence suggests that 1 in 4 people will experience a mental health condition across their lifespan, yet we don't talk about it. Right. And then we feel alone when we're really, you know, part of a very large group of people with a shared experience. And that's really what storytelling is all about. When it comes to mental health, you know, the tricky thing about this particular health condition, and other health conditions share this characteristics too, is that it's a concealable identity. So if you don't tell somebody that you're struggling, for the most part, aside from like extreme symptoms, right, nobody would know. And so the contact-based approach to stigma change, which is storytelling that I described earlier, is really about making what's unseen seen. And what the research that my research lab has conducted suggests is that in doing so, not only is stigma reduced and willingness to seek treatment improved by people who witness those stories, but also people perceive themselves as less different from the storyteller when they hear these stories. And that's a big driver of discrimination. So that's a really important outcome of storytelling. Additionally, so I'll give a concrete example and also a shameless plug for this intervention. One of my, you know, longest standing community partners is an organization called This Is My Brave. And they do storytelling around mental health and addiction through creative expression. So some of you may have seen advertisements over the past couple of years where we've actually brought this program to USF, and we've invited USF students living with mental health conditions to audition and then go through the rehearsal process and take the stage in a theatrical performance where they tell their stories of both their challenges with their mental health condition, their experiences with stigma, but also their recovery journey and their message of hope. And they do that through creative expression. So we've had monologues, we've had song, we have stand-up comedians that take the stage. I know that sounds like it wouldn't work, but it actually is effective for reducing stigma. And why I wanted to bring that particular intervention up is because it really does target stigma from multiple different perspectives. The audience that comes to observe the show experiences, through our research, we've shown experiences those reductions in stigma and improvements in treatment seeking. But we're also gathering data from our cast members. And, you know, a cast is 8 to 10 people at a time. So it's taking us some time to accumulate this data. And we're very close to having the sample size we need to be able to rigorously analyze this and be able to say something about changes in our cast. But preliminarily, what I'm seeing is that self-stigma is reduced and recovery is improved among the people who share their stories on stage. So it's beneficial, not just for, you know, opening up the conversation, but there's true benefits to the individual who is able to, you know, unveil that hidden stigmatized identity and share their truth. So my shameless plug is that our show date for 2024 is April 5th. So if you're interested in seeing that performance, we did in our 2022 show, we did have actually a very brave medical student from USF take the stage, Ashwarya Vapala, and you could see her performance on YouTube. All of these stories are captured by a professional videographer. And I say very brave because there is such a heightened stigma in the medical community because of things like Dr. Davidson mentioned, these violations of the ADA with the questions on licensure and certification exams. So I hope, did that answer your question,
Dr.? Yeah, no, I think it is important that we think about all the different ways, and particularly as we build the evidence base for what may be effective. As you say, we, you know, we're scientists and we believe in the evidence base, and then we ignore it. Or as one of our speakers said this morning, you know, yeah, there's the science, there's the logical part, but there's the emotional part and how we experience our work and the challenges that work presents. You know, I'm also struck when you talked about, unrevealed illness, was that the phrase you used? And I forget what speaker kind of showed, sort of, you know, there's chronic illness or chronic pain, which also might not be evident, and which you may also hide as a health provider, because you don't want anyone to know that maybe you're less able to do your job, especially in the PT area or in nursing, where you're, you know, lifting and moving, and you know, you wouldn't want anyone to know that you're hindered, which then can create then the cycle which leads to other stress. Yeah. And it's interesting to me, because if one of you broke a leg, we would understand that that would have to be accommodated. Your work would be adapted while you healed from the broken leg, right? Mm-hmm. So it almost seems like we have to get to a point where any injury or, you know, any illness that requires an adaptation in the workplace should be accepted, right? I mean, I think I heard a couple speakers say that we have to sort of stop saying, well, that's an unacceptable illness. Having a substance abuse problem or a mental health challenge is an unacceptable illness in this profession. I think I heard speakers say that just should not, again, we shouldn't be assuming anything. We should assess competence and the ability to do a job, and then provide whatever accommodations we need to provide. I don't know if anybody has a comment on that idea. While you're thinking about that, what I want to do, because I want to give time for our audience to ask questions, is to just ask all of you to reflect on what you heard this morning, and to share sort of what really struck you as something you want to make sure that our audience today takes home. But I'll start. Abraham raised his hand. Thank you, Dr. Salinas.
Yes, I wanted to to point to expand a little bit about that last comment. We, for the audience, it would be a very important thing that if you can take home this message, everybody has been exposed to traumatic stress. So mental health is not just for those who have diagnosed depression or anxiety or need mental health care services. Everybody, trauma is ubiquitous. So starting conversation, recognizing, normalizing the conversation about addressing my traumatic stress should be just as much as getting a vaccination. Yeah, I just wanted to add that comment.
Thank you, Abraham. Other things that our panelists would encourage the audience to take away from today's morning session.
I'll chime in. And yes, options. One of the things that I took away that I think is important, I mean, and the speakers were great. I took away a lot. But I wrote this down, and one of the speakers said, you know, identify professionals when you're thinking of developing, a collaboration with other professionals. Get professional, and this is sort of paraphrasing, get professionals who are positive and who want to do the work to address mental health concerns. And I think that's very important. And I think she said, they don't have to be like-minded individuals, but, you know, as long as the goal is as long as you have the same goal, you know, that's important. So I think that's an important thing because, you know, trying to get these initiatives off the ground, you know, it's a heavy lift. So you want people who are goal directed, right? So that's my take.
Thank you. Kelly?
I think to add to what Dr. Simmons said, so for me, and this is something that I share with my students, and I have to tell myself this, I need to be cared for in order to care for others. So if it doesn't start with me and my internal motivation, and we know from the literature that internal motivation is what really drives us as individuals, then how can I care for my patients? And maybe that means taking a wellness day for myself so that I could go practice mindfulness or meditation or go exercise or something, practice something in the wellness domains so that I could better care for my patients.
Yeah, I'll just piggyback off of what you just said, Dr. Allegro. And that is, I really resonated with this idea of peer support. And I've done quite a bit of work with the first responder community during COVID through the Pandemic Research Response Network grants, and heard time and time again from first responders, which broadly included doctors and nurses, as well as law enforcement and emergency responders, that, you know, because of things like these questions on exams, and this is our current reality, right? These questions exist right now. We're this important work is happening to change them, but it's still impacting willingness to seek treatment. Peer support is an antidote to stigma in that way, in that it allows for people to receive care when they might not practice self-care. So Dr. Westfall was talking about, you know, just acknowledging the fact that this community is culturally, you know, conditioned and prone to want to care for others and not so much themselves. So the peer support allows them to receive that care from another individual, and to provide that care to someone else. So that I think is a really important takeaway, is the importance of peer support in an interprofessional setting.
Yeah, and I both of you are kind of getting at this. If we enter these professions because we care and we want to care for people and we want to improve people's lives, it's easy to lose ourselves in that work. But you can't be effective in that work if you aren't yourself whole, as I think all of our speakers said. I think one of the things that struck me was, I think when Dr. Bickle was speaking about how important it is, I think it was what she who said, you know, it's important to choose your environment. I had never thought about it that way. But if, you know, when you're, and again, we've got a lot of students on this call and they'll be thinking about their career paths. But your career path includes going to institutions or organizations to work. And maybe one thing we can do to help is come up with a set of questions that people should ask when they're looking at a place of employment. What is the culture like here? Do they attend to the well-being of their workforce? Are there programs in place? You know, is this a culture that supports the caregivers? You know, I don't know. I just thought of that. That might be something we should work on. The other thing that struck me listening to all of you, and I think several of our speakers alluded to this, we're not just workers. You know, we have families, we have our own lives, we have our own communities. And as Dr. Salinas just said, we're all exposed to trauma and it could be anywhere. So this idea of from the sort of occupational health world is total worker health, like thinking about the person. It's not just the work environment that can create stress or provide opportunity. It's also everything outside, and that we have to understand when people come to us, they're bringing their whole self when they come. And that sometimes I think I've seen in workplaces, you know, they'll focus on the work stress, but maybe not necessarily other things that may be impacting that. So lots of really good food for thought here. I saw Dr. Okuda pop on.
Dr. Petersen, Dr. Bickel is still on and she's willing to participate in the discussion. I think you had brought up a point that she may have made. I didn't know if she wanted to make a comment on it.
Sure. Thanks. I think my camera is, oh, there we go.
There you are.
Yeah. So I've been loving the conversation, love it in a lot of ways. And I just sent you a message in the private chat saying that yes, absolutely. We don't know the right questions to ask. Right? We ask questions about how much we're going to get paid. We ask questions about benefits. We ask questions about those things that matter. We ask a lot about what hours will work, and those things matter. But we don't ask questions like, how are your leaders selected? How are leaders trained? Do I have opportunity for coaching and professional development? How do we address when mistakes are made in healthcare environments? Because mistakes will be made. Will you blame me or will you approach a system approach? And how are we inclusive of ideas? How do we disagree respectfully, right? Those are awkward questions to ask. I mean, it's already awkward enough to ask how much money you're going to make. So, but I do think that it is imperative that we train, because until we start asking organizations these questions, they won't know that it's important for recruitment. And right now, organizations want more of us, not less of us. And so this is the opportunity for us to become more skilled.
Yeah, and I think we also heard that, you know, when you do this well, you do retain workers at a higher rate.
Yep.
And you know, the whole recruitment retention cycle can be very expensive if not managed well. So I think what we're kind of hitting on here is really focusing on not just recruitment in, but I'm recruiting a place to work.
Yep.
And there needs to be a good cultural fit, and then the retention should come from that. We did have a couple comments and questions in here. Somebody was, I think, agreeing that the concept of providing accommodations for physical disabilities is the same way we need to establish accommodations for a mental health disability in the context that is the job function still attainable. So the way we do accommodations now is the way we should do them for any kind of illness. And then here's a question. I actually had this thought too, so I'm really glad this person asked this. How do we approach the time it takes to address mental health and stigma? Healthcare providers are known for working long hours. How do we ensure we can do our jobs appropriately and effectively while also taking care of our mental health and the health of those around us? Not all practices have the resources to allow time off for mental health, or we are spread too thin to take on our own self-care or the mental health of our peers. Great question. I had it myself. So any of our panelists want to comment on how do you find room for this in a very busy work environment?
I'm happy to make a
comment. Sure, because it's part of your job. So we love
it. Yeah. So anything that you mentioned in wellness, time is always going to be given as a barrier. Always, right? And time and resources. I'm not sure if there's anything that time and resources are not a barrier for.
Right. But
for whatever reason, when it comes to wellness, we bring up the aspect of time more than anything, right? You know, and so sometimes I think it's about that we, I'm a big believer that anything is better than nothing. So people sometimes make this absolute, I can't do wellness because I don't have time. Well, practicing three good things, there was some mention earlier today about gratitude. Practicing three good things is an evidence-based intervention that only takes 5 minutes. It only takes 5 minutes. It might not be a full day, but it only takes 5 minutes. One of the practices I do is I actually, sometimes if I'm in a busy clinic day, I'll actually meditate as I'm walking to the floor. I mean, as I'm walking into a room to give myself presence, right? None of that took time. I understand we are very pressured. I understand all of those different things. And I've got four kids too on at the boot, you know, like, and so one of the aspects of it too is of how do we block those times ahead of time to prioritize that in our life, right? And that when we, again, one of the symptoms of burnout is reduced professional efficiency. And so basically what I say is, I don't think that we have time not to do it.
Yeah.
Because right now we are wasting time on rumination. We're wasting time on decreased efficiency, and that the only way to get more time back is actually through it.
Thank you, Dr. Bickel. Dr. Allegro.
I love everything you just said. And one thing that I often tell my students, and I think they're not very happy with me when I say it, time is, you know, the biggest barrier that individuals say is their barrier to wellness. But time is a perceived barrier. And I say that because going to what you were saying about prioritizing, how do we prioritize our day? What is important to you? For me personally, physical wellness, that physical wellness domain is really important. That means I'm a mom of two. I have a full-time job. I wake up at 5 a.m. to go exercise because that is the time of day and that is my dedicated time to exercise. And in my calendar, I sometimes put yoga and I'll do a 15-minute yoga and I block my calendar. I start my week and I say, okay, what are my needs and how can I put that, add those times into my calendar? And my work partner knows that when I have that time blocked, you know, unless there's an absolute emergency, don't come knocking on my door because that is my self-care time.
Yeah, all good things to do for ourselves, but also to keep an eye on our coworkers as well. While you're doing that, well, what are they doing? How are we giving them that space too? Dr. Salinas.
Yes, I wanted to mention that, and this is something that has been mentioned by other presenters as well. Yes, time constraints are always an issue. A hierarchical system is always an issue. But why, in certain days, you're able to go through that time constraint and you did not feel threatened? It's the perceived threat response that these environments create on us. We do have a sense of agency that we can control. It's this perception of threat that we can control on a daily basis. So what I'm trying to assess here is how can we create activities in the workplace that foster relaxation, that foster relationship building, so we, our windows of tolerance for perceived threats is actually widened. So I would challenge, yes, time constraints are an issue, but why certain people under the same time constraint do better than others? So this is the key aspect that we need to think about. Yeah.
Thank you, Abraham. Dr. Kosyluk.
Yeah, I just wanted to say something based on what Dr. Salinas just shared. And that is, I talked about storytelling and changing stigma in that way. And it has to happen from the highest levels of the organization so that message trickles down that it's okay not to be okay. I think the same thing applies to this issue around time. And unfortunately, what we see is folks that are in, you know, higher up administrative positions, they're being watched by their, you know, employees and seeing whether or not they're taking time off work, whether they're using their PTO time. whether they're saying no to certain things because they don't have the time for it. And so I really do think that that messaging needs to come down from the highest levels of an organization in order for culture to shift within that organization.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And there was a comment in the chat about, you know, not everyone has sort of equal access to this kind of time that we're talking about and the ability to shape their time and why it's important to advocate. And I was also struck by a couple of our speakers talked about, you know, stop doing stupid stuff. We went through an exercise like that years ago, and it was amazing how much we found that didn't need to happen. You know, there was some rule put in place however many years ago, and everyone kept churning out the paper to comply with the rule that had been eliminated years ago. But you know, there's that, but then there's also just the way our systems operate. And we heard a lot about electronic health records and the burden of charting and, you know, working with these systems. And so I think part of what we need to be assessing within our own work and our own teams is what is it that keeps us from doing the things we want to do, which is probably providing great care to patients or communities, but also providing care for each other. If we can start talking about these things out loud, then we might be able to say and advocate with our leaders to be models of the right kind of behavior. As you just said, Kelly, really, or Kristin, really important, because people will look up and say, well, she never stops, he never stops. They're sending me emails all night long, which you should not do. And I think well, I forget, one of you said, you know, Christopher said it earlier, gratitude. And as a leader, being present to say, wow, thank you for what you're doing. Tell me what's happening here. You know, how can I be helpful? All of that matters. You all know the Maya Angelou line: people don't remember what you say or what you did, but they remember how you made them feel. And a lot of what we're talking about here really gets down to just how in the moment you are feeling. And I think our first speaker talked about, you know, there might be those moments where you're tired, or there might be those moments where something terrible happened, but that's different than what we're talking about here. We're talking about the accumulation of repeated stressors and repeated trauma. And we have to find a better way to care for each other, because we all know that we're experiencing this. So, I mean, I think I've heard a lot of great ideas here, just saying things out loud, expressing these views, assessing this in a meaningful way, sharing back what that information reveals, leaders recognizing this and putting in place creating a culture that supports this. All of this is really important. So not easy work by any stretch of the imagination, but very necessary work if we're going to fulfill our responsibilities as healthcare teams. Let me see someone else comment here. So the idea of expressing health of a workplace environment, socioeconomic factors play a crucial role in allowing people the mental space to develop questions pertaining to the evaluation of quality for work environments. Absolutely. Primary concerns for people surrounding employment are centralized around sustaining employment to maintain family support and lifestyle rather than a focus on health. Again, yeah, we look at the salary, we look at the work hours, we may even look at the status and the prestige. We look about, you know, we look for a long-term commitment, but in fact, that may all be fine, but it may not be actually contributing to a quality of life that we all need to enjoy. So with that, I think, unless anyone has any last words, this was fantastic. I'm so blessed to have such wonderful colleagues. Any last words from our panelists? Thank you all so much.
I just had one thing to say. I was so happy to hear Dr. Bickle allude to three good things. It's a part of a course that I teach, and you know, just the whole greater good science center has been a good resource, and I think it could be a good resource to the listeners on the call as well. So it was good hearing that. I do three good things every night. Yeah,
Dr. Simmons, can you just briefly mention to the audience what that is, just in case people don't know?
I'll paraphrase, and Dr. Bickle could jump in, but I do a variation of it. It's it's really thinking, and it's backed by science. That's the good thing. There's empirical evidence for its effectiveness. It's actually just thinking of three good things that happen during the day, and just sort of reflecting on those three good things, because like a lot of times our minds go to, especially when you're about to go to bed, go to sleep, you think about all the things that you've done during the day, all the negative things, the things that you wish you could have changed, right? And that's a terrible time to think about those things, especially if you're trying to get sleep. So you think about three good things and you just reflect on those things, think about why they were good, think about, just everything around that. And if you do that for a certain period of time, you start during the day, you start to think about those good things. You could identify those good things. And if you're thinking about good things and that's sort of the thing, right? You're not thinking about the negatives, right? It's just a good exercise. There's also three funny things. If you wanted to think about three funny things during the day, it has pretty much the same effect.
And like many things today, there's an app for that. Dr. Bickle put it in the chat.
There's an app for that.
There's an app for that.
I didn't know that, but that's good to know.
So anyway, outstanding. Yes, Dr. Salinas.
Yes, just wanted to expand on the metrics. I put some questions in the chat about the things that we could ask in interprofessional teams based on the science of relational health. Do we feel that we can talk about our feelings? Do we feel our work environment supports us? Do I feel a sense of belonging? Do I enjoy participating in teams, traditions at work? All those things are good questions, as well as, am I safe? Do I feel safe here? Emotionally safe. So thank you.
Good. Lots of good tools, lots of good thoughts to contemplate, and hopefully lots of good work to do going forward. We know our students, we have great hope for the future because they're outstanding. And with great colleagues like these, we know they are learning how to be successful health professionals, but also successful human beings, so that we can continue to care for each other and the people that we serve.